You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download. Okay, so here we are back in the project we started in the previous exercise. And we're not really seeing very much. And that's because even though we have a project, we don't have anything to work on. Because when we're starting to work, we need to create a session. And it's these sessions where we're going to be doing all our compositing, rotoscoping, and painting. And every project can have multiple sessions within it. So we can easily try things out, make experiments, and make failures. So here's how we start a session. If I have my source selected, I can come down to the bottom down here, and I can click on my new session button. This will bring up my new session window where I can give it another name. I don't really know what I want to call this yet, so I'm going to leave this at new session one, and we can choose a template to use. Now, just as we had when we started the After Effects project last time, we don't have to use a template. It's just an easy way of adding in nodes for us. So I'm going to leave this to a roto template, and from the workspace here, we can choose which workspace we want to work with. Currently, we're looking at a composite workspace, so I'm going to leave this at composite right now, even though this might not be what we eventually end up using. And with regards to the format, again, we can choose one of the presets that we have down here. I'm going to be working at 1080:25, and that'll populate the details it needs for frame size, pixel aspect, and FPS. The duration that comes automatically is determined by the source footage. So our source clip is 451 frames long, and it defaults to the full length of the clip. We can make that longer or shorter if we want to. And again, the start frame as well is going to come from the clip. So our clip start frame starts at 8,000. So Silhouette assumes that you might want to start from 8,000 to match those up. We can, of course, change this to whatever we want, but I'll leave this at 8,000. And as we saw in the last exercise when we started the After Effects comp, we can choose our working depth here between 8-bit, 16-bit, and float 32. The higher the bit depth, the more you're going to make your system work for it. But if we're working with big raw images, or we're doing lots of compositing work that requires colors or lots of nodes, we might want to consider one of the float depths. At the moment, I'm not really concerned about that. We can change all this a bit later. I'm going to choose 8-bit so we can keep working fast. And our source footage is only 8-bit JPEG anyway. All right, so let's hit OK. And a few things start to happen. Now we've got a workspace that's interesting enough to talk about. So let's break this down. At the very top, we have our menu bar. And we will explore these as and when we need to. Just under that, we have our viewer controls. And we have different ones on the left-hand side and the right-hand side. Over on the left edge, we have our tools. The main bulk of the screen is being taken up by our viewer. And at the bottom of the viewer, we have ways of playing our clips back. So the standard viewer controls, play forwards, play one frame forwards, go to the end, go to the start. Just to the right-hand side of the viewer, we have our trees window, which is where we have a drop-down for our active session, plus our node tree. And this will start to build up and look a little bit more interesting as we move along. Moving down to the bottom now, in the bottom left, we have our sources that we've already seen. We have our timeline, which updates along with the viewer and is going to be our connection to all of the keyframes and animation that we're going to be making soon. Further over to the right is the object list. This is where our roto objects are going to be popping up. And over in the bottom right-hand corner, we have our parameters. And these are broken up into tabs. So we have node parameters, object parameters. We also have presets and notes as well. And we're going to come back to all of these in a little bit. In the very bottom right-hand corner is something that's going to be our friend a little bit later. And that is our cache display. So the cache display is going to display the number of frames loaded into RAM and the percentage of RAM that we are using to cache them. So if I play my whole clip through now, the frames that we haven't seen before are going to be loaded into the cache, and the cache display is going to update to show that for us as well. Until we reach the full number of frames we've got, 451, and that's how many are cached. The more nodes we add in and the more memory intensive our tree becomes, that number of available frames is going to shrink down for us as well. And one last thing, when we come to the interface, if we have a look over at our trees, we can be moving our nodes around, and the connections we get will move with us. And this gives us a visual representation of the flow that we have in our project. At the moment, we have just three nodes in here. We have our source node, which is currently visible in the viewer, and is also the active node in the parameters down at the bottom, flowing in to an input in the rotor node. In fact, the foreground input, if we just hover over there, we get tooltips that show us what's going on. If I click on my rotor node now, you'll see that this is what's being displayed in the viewer. And we can see the edit node button is active here, which means that the rotor node is now active in our parameter display. We can also see that the output of our rotor node is flowing into the input of our output node. And the output node is what's going to be saved out, whether that's to a file or if we're using the plugin directly out into the host. And I can just select either the view node icon here, which means that this node is being displayed in the viewer, or just click on the edit node button on a particular node, and that's what will update into the parameter display. So we can be viewing one node and editing another node. And this is really useful when we start building up our project, because we can see the consequences of what's happening to something that's further upstream. And of course, all of these concepts are going to become clearer and more relevant as we start to push on in our project, which is exactly what we're going to start to do in the next exercise, where we're going to start to look at our shot and see what it is we're actually going to do with it. So join me after the jump.